Good morning and welcome to St. Paul's. This morning we continue with our series, What Do We Do When Plans Fall Through? And this morning we take a look at When All You Can Do Is Go For a Walk. May God bless you in your worship this morning.
What is our hope in life and death? Christ alone, Christ alone. What is our only confidence? That our souls to Him belong. Who holds our days within His hand? What comes apart from His command? And what will keep us to the end? The love of Christ in which we stand. Oh, sing soul. God is good, God is good. Where is His grace and goodness known? In our great Redeemer's blood, who holds our faith when fears arise, who stands above the stormy trial, who sends the waves that bring us nigh. Unto the shore, the rock of Christ. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess, Christ our hope in life and death. Christ He lives, Christ He lives, and what reward will heaven bring? Everlasting life with Him, there we will rise to meet the Lord. Then sin and death will be destroyed, and we will feast in endless joy when Christ is ours.
Join in confessing our sins. We have come into the presence of God, who created us to love and serve Him as His dear children, but we have disobeyed Him and deserve only His wrath and punishment. Therefore, let us confess our sins to Him and plead for His mercy. Merciful Father in heaven, I am altogether sinful from birth. In countless ways I have sinned against You, and do not deserve to be called Your child. But trusting in Jesus, my Savior, I pray, Have mercy on me according to your unfailing love. Cleanse me from my sin and take away my guilt. God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven all your sins. By the perfect life and innocent death of our Lord Jesus Christ, he has removed your guilt forever. You are his own dear child. May God give you strength to live according to his will. Amen.
His greatness no one can fathom. One generation will commend your works unto another. They will tell of your mighty acts, so that all men may know. They will tell of your mighty acts and the splendor. All those who are bowed down, the eyes of all look to you, and you give them food at the proper time. You open your hand and satisfy the desires of everything. You open your hand and satisfy the desires of everything. Desires of those who fear him, he hears their cry and saves them. You open your hand and satisfy the desires of everything. You open your hand and satisfy the desires of everything. They will tell of your mighty acts, so that all
gospel lesson for this morning, and our sermon text for this morning is found in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, beginning with verse 13. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. that some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus. He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going further. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening, the day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" And they got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11, and along with them assembled, and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." And the two told what had happened on the way, and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. This is the gospel of our Lord.
When dying in Jesus' promise, I
Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Dear Christian friends, sometimes it's hard for us to see the big picture. I can remember at some point when I was a kid that I had this crazy idea that had floated through my mind. I wondered what it would look like being up high in the sky and looking down on the ground below me. I wondered what it might look like from the sky, what our house looked like from way up there, what our neighborhood looked like, what our town that I lived in looked like. And so I came up with this crazy idea in my mind. I wondered if it would be possible that somehow I could take this small, cheap little camera I had, attach it to a group of helium balloons, and tie it all to a string and let it rise up in the air and see if I could somehow take a picture of what was below. I never could figure out how to make it happen, because you see, that cheap little camera I had, it didn't have any timer on it. It had no way that I could come up with a way for it to be able to take that picture. And so I guess I just kind of gave up on the idea. Because you see, sometimes it's hard to see the big picture. This morning we continue our series, What Do You Do When Plans Fall Through? And this morning we want to see that sometimes when those plans all fall through, the only thing we can do is go for a walk. These two disciples on the way to Emmaus, they were struggling. They were struggling to understand what had happened a few days before that. Because you see, the disciples had plans for Jesus. They had seen all that Jesus had done, but they couldn't get past the cross. Because see, sometimes it's hard to see the big picture. To kind of illustrate that, I want you to pretend for a moment that I take this camera that I'm talking into and zoom in on my shoe that I'm wearing. If I zoomed in far enough, would you be able to tell that it was my shoe? Perhaps you could tell that it was a shoe, but not who it belonged to. But what if I could zoom in even further? That I could zoom in as far as just, not just the shoe, but on a single strand, a single thread in that shoe. Would you be able even to see that it was a shoe? It's hard to see the big picture. As those disciples walked along, they were having trouble seeing the big picture. They were having trouble to see the shoe, the thread. But the camera needed to be pulled back out. These disciples were not unknown to Jesus. Perhaps these two disciples that were walking this road to Emmaus were part of that larger group of disciples that followed Jesus. Part of that group of 70. The group of people that Jesus sent out two by two to go and do his work in the area. The 70 who came back in Jesus' ministry, all excited that they saw what Jesus' word had done for people. But on this day, they still don't get it. I can't even imagine what it must have been like for those disciples to walk along with Jesus, perhaps for those several years, be able to ask him any question that they wanted to ask, and they would know and be given every single answer by Jesus. They would have perhaps seen the miracles that Jesus had performed. They saw the crowds that followed Jesus. They saw the crowds that just a week ago had followed Jesus into Jerusalem on that Palm Sunday. But then came Good Friday, all their hopes, all their plans were dashed. All they could see was Jesus had failed. Jesus knew what they were talking about on the road there, and at that point, Jesus had not revealed to them who he truly was. And so he plays kind of dumb and says, "What are you talking about?" And those two disciples almost look at Jesus and said, "We're talking about everything that's going on right now in Jerusalem." And Jesus says, "What things are going on?" And they look at Jesus with that look that says, "You know, how can you not know what's going on?" And then those disciples say those words, "But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel." All they could see was Jesus was a failure. They couldn't get past the cross. And so Jesus begins to teach them. He wants to show them that they needed to pull back the camera. They needed to see the big picture of who Jesus was. And so he says to them, "How foolish you are. How slow to believe all the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. And so as those disciples walked along the road on the way to Emmaus, with faces downcast, Jesus began from the beginning to teach. All we're told that Jesus taught from Moses and the prophets. We're not told exactly what parts Jesus spoke to them. But I imagine that Jesus spoke to those disciples and began with creation. And as he began with creation, he said of how God had placed Adam and Eve in this perfect world, and then they fell into sin. But God was not going to leave this world alone. And so he spoke about the one who would come, who would crush the head of the serpent. Perhaps Jesus began also or continued on to speak about Isaiah, of how this servant was coming who was going to suffer and die, who was going to pay for sins and was going to be led as a lamb to the slaughter. Jesus spoke to them, perhaps, many of the other prophecies that were recorded in God's Word. And as he did, he continued to pull that camera further and further back, because you see, God's plan was much bigger than just a week or a weekend. That Jesus was really part of God's perfect plan for this world. He wanted them to see the big picture. To kind of sometimes illustrate how hard it is for us to understand and see the big picture, how easy it is for us to just focus in on a certain event that happens in our life. There is a story of an old Chinese farmer. He lived in a small town, and he had something that small village that no one else had, and that was that farmer had a horse. That farmer was, even to some degree, the envy of that town. But they also liked the farmer who had a horse. One day, the horse ran away, and the horse did not come back the next day. The townspeople went to that farmer and said, "What a shame. What a shame it is that you had lost your horse." The farmer shrugged his shoulders and said to them, "Perhaps it's a bad thing, perhaps not. Who knows what's going to happen?" A day or two later, the farmer's horse came back. But this time, the horse came back not alone. he brought a second horse along. The townspeople went to that farmer once again and said to him, "Oh, how fortunate you are." And the farmer looked at them and said, "Perhaps. Perhaps I'm fortunate. Perhaps not. Who knows?" A day or two later, the farmer's son was breaking in that new horse. And the horse threw the farmer's son from the back of that horse. As the farmer's son landed on the ground, he broke his arm. And he broke it in a nasty way. Townspeople once again went out to the farmer and said, "What a shame." And the farmer said, "Maybe yes, maybe no. Who knows?" The next day, a group of the emperor's army came into that small village. They were recruiting people for the emperor's army. They weren't just asking for volunteers. They were taking all of the young men who were strong, who were healthy, and drafted them that day for the army. Not by choice, but by force. They came and looked at the farmer's son, and they said, "What a shame. How fortunate you are that you didn't lose your son like the rest of us had." And the farmer said, "How fortunate. Maybe so, maybe not. Who knows?" That farmer, in all things, worked out for him and his family. And all things might work out for us in our lives. And yet how hard it is for us sometimes to see the big picture. That sometimes you and I are like that Chinese farmer. We look at the events that happen in our lives and we say how fortunate or unfortunate they are. Who knows? Maybe they are, maybe they're not. That's how those two disciples on the road to Emmaus felt. They couldn't see the big picture. They couldn't see that it was all fortunate to them. That perhaps they thought they just walked along. Maybe so, maybe not. Who knows? Jesus wanted them to see. God knows. That things that were spinning out of control in their lives, they weren't spinning out of control. That you and I look at things around us and we think that maybe Jesus is a failure. Maybe things are just spiraling out of control. And we're tempted to think, who knows? God knows. He knew exactly what these two disciples need to see. He wanted them to see the big picture. As they came to rest that night, Jesus then opened their eyes and they saw who Jesus was. That day they had began with just a walk. But later that night, they began to run. And perhaps through the dark in that night, they ran those 7 miles back to Jerusalem to see the disciples and tell them what they had seen along the road. That they had a Savior who had rescued them. And they marveled at what the Savior had taught them. And their hearts were burning. That as they walked along that road, they no longer saw a Savior who was crushed. They saw a Savior who loved them. And so, my dear friends, those times that your plans fall through, perhaps you need to go for a walk. To go for a walk with Jesus. To see a Savior who loves you. And so what do you do when your plans fall through? Go take a walk with Jesus, both now and forever. Amen. May the peace of God that surpasses all understanding keep your hearts and your minds in Jesus. Amen. we pray. Dear Lord God, we give you thanks that when there are times that we are focused on events in our life and the pains and the hurts, it is so easy for us to not see the big picture. And then we see you pulling back the camera, helping us to see the big picture as we walk this road of life, that we are not alone, that you are with us, helping us to see your plans for us, helping them to see that we don't walk the roads of this life by ourselves, but we walk them with you. May you always be our hope, our strength. Amen. Praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Now, with the blessing of your God, may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Jesus Christ is risen today. Alleluia. Our triumphant holy day. Alleluia. Who did once upon the cross. Alleluia. Suffer to to Christ our heavenly King, alleluia. Who endured the cross and grave, alleluia. Sinners to redeem and save, alleluia. Ever sing, alleluia.